What's up? This is day 344. And today, I'm working on NPCs some more. I got a few things left on my list that need to be done before this NPC can be considered totally done. Basically just refinement, things like that. Also today, I'm going to be adding some items. So, one thing I'm working on right now is getting it so it zooms in just right. So if he's a little bit too far to the right, let's check it out there. Jib's kind of too far down below. His dialogue appears off the screen. So I need it so when it does this zoom in, it focuses on all the heroes and NPCs. What's up, Arcane? This is what he looks like right here. This is Brutus. Yeah, so it does this little zoom in, and you just gotta get that zoom in so it includes all the characters on the screen. What's up, Jonah? Oh, and I was working on this where you can run off the screen before the dialogue starts. Oh, I gotta check that in. So yeah, these are the things left to do with Brutus. And I'm also going to create some new items today. So Brutus is going to have a quest where basically he says, go get me some liquor. And you go to the store and you grab him some liquor and bring him back the flask full of liquor. And he's like, all right, thanks. He drinks the liquor and gives you your first flask. And flasks can revive you. So when you die, if you have a full flask, you get some life back, just like a fairy from Zelda. So, flask, also cactus pouches. Yeah, plenty of work to do today. So I wonder if I fixed this where you can run off the screen before dialogue starts. I guess I did, technically. I guess I should throw this down here. Oh yeah, also make dialogue and lens delayed until running area for a second or so. I could do that right now. What's inside the flask? Spirits. Like liquor, basically. Red Sands, thank you, man. Good morning. Thanks for saying the force be with me. The force be with you, too. Don't need this input lock. And the delay I only had there because I wanted to do... making them delayed for a second. Oh yeah, that too. All right, yeah, lots of things to get done. I think I should, well, yeah, let me check this code in I got already. This is kind of a one step towards something here. What's up, Boogie? Welcome. All right, I added that. Checking that, and that's good. So basically that little change made it so dialogue is only possible once the flux is finished. How it is? It's good. How about yourself, Boogie? How you doing, Boogie? What's new? You good? Right on. What's up, Teak? You're cold? What are you cold for? Isaac Tears. Okay, so a delay before dialogue or lens is dynamic. Oh, it's winter, huh? Ah, hot breath. No way, there's a new Windows 10 update that has Bash. Oh my god, that's really cool, Arcane. Hey, oh my gosh, I gotta mention this. I started playing Hyper Light Drifter. Oh my god. Have you guys played Hyper Light Drifter yet? Yeah, I know some people were mentioning it earlier this week. This game is a complete work of art. It's so amazing. Now it's too hot. Yeah. Oh my gosh. This game, if you guys haven't seen it, it's also a Zelda inspired game. Amazing game. The Kickstarter for this game raised $650,000. I believe they've already made $1 million this week. Oh yeah, that is really cool. So it's going to be released on Windows pretty soon, huh? The new Linux commands. That's sweet. We've needed Bash on Windows forever, right? That's like the one part of the... Look at this, still on the trending top lists. And what do we got now? Owners, 88. So yeah, 88,000 people roughly own this game. And it's now $20. It was $18 earlier this week. Assuming like industry standards here, and assuming on the safe side. So let's say we have 80,000 people that have bought Hyper Light Drifter so far, times let's just say $20 each. Well, we'll do 18. That's the low side. Times 70% standard. Yeah, that's about $1 million they've made already. But anyways, you know, they totally deserve it. This game is so amazing. Just got a shout out. They killed it with being 30 frames per second. Yeah, I agree. It's hard to control. That's probably the one drawback to this game is it's incredibly difficult, too. I don't know if it's just me, but I got my ass kicked. I can't even beat the first level. I actually almost rage quit last night. And I mean, I didn't rage because it's such an amazing game. I'm just like so into the world. It's so awesome, man. This game is, like I said, it's a true work of art. So inspiring. But anyways, I just want to give a shout out to Hyper Light Drifter because that's such a great success in the indie scene to see a game do that. They did a Kickstarter. They did everything about their game incredibly well. He hired a bunch of people to help him. They've been working on this game 3.5 years. Such a great game. And of course, it's, you know, inspired by the same game, same set of games that Songbringer is, Zelda, the Zelda series. And there's a lot of sci-fi influences too, which is also a big influence on Songbringer. So similar birds of a feather, if you will. Birds of a feather kind of games. Okay, so back to this. Yeah, so I heard it was made in Game Maker, right? People reported that. I don't know if I believe it even now that I'm playing it, but I guess it could be made in Game Maker. I'm not sure if they switched that or not. You know, they might have started it in Game Maker and then finished it in something else. I don't know. Okay, so what's next on my list? Yeah, so I want to make. Oh yeah, I'm gonna get the items started. So there's three new items I want to. Well, two types of items I want to add right now. Yeah, it is. It's cool. It's cool to see that done in Game Maker. I'm impressed. It would be way hard to switch an engine midway in a game, but they spent 3.5 years making it, so that's what makes me wonder, like at some point, and they had so many people working on it too. It's like, I think they had around, I don't know, 8 to 10 people working on that game. So that's why I'm like, man, how did they spend 3.5 years and that long and that many people and not switch an engine or something in the middle? Because a lot of the art you see was similar to what they had in the Kickstarter 3.5 years ago. Yo-Yo says it is. Wow. And that was just a few. God, that was just like right now. Awesome. Yeah, incredible game. I'm so excited for those guys. What's the guy's name that was the head of it all? I think his name was like Alex or something like that from LA. Genius, absolute genius. The art is just so incredible. Okay, so we need an item. New items. What's up, PMC? Welcome, man. We're just chatting about Hyperlight. Alex Preston, that's it, yeah. We're chatting about Hyperlight Drifter a bit. Have you played it, PMC? We got bomb containers, keys, switches. Right by the bomb container and the live container, we're gonna have a new kind of item called the cactus container. And how many of these are we going to have? I'm thinking each cactus container holds three cacti. Yeah, it looks good. I haven't played it. That's how it was for me yesterday. I finally bought it last night or 2 days, 2 nights ago, whatever. Started playing it. So impressed. Oh my God. And people were telling me the intro was good, but dude, once you experience that thing's intro, it'll change. It almost changes your life. You're like, oh my God, this is the best intro I've ever seen for a video game. So three cacti per container. If you had nine of them, that would be 27 cacti you could pick up. Each one of them fills one heart, and you have like 14 hearts or whatever. So that's a lot of cacti if you had nine of them. That's pretty good. Let's start with nine. Might be too much, but. I mean, you can always take them away, right? You don't have to put every one of these items in the whole world. There's nine cactus containers. Maybe the cactus container will have two each. And that way you could hold like 18. I don't know. I guess it doesn't matter that much. Okay, so now we're also gonna have flasks. Flasks are something where you hold they hold spirits, and then when you die, it brings you back to life. Spirits like liquor, basically. So there's a full flask, which is full of liquor, and then there's an empty flask, which is ready to be filled up with liquor. Yeah, so I guess it's gonna be K. Well, I guess a flask could change. I don't know. You're going to Kurdistan? Nice. You're gonna play Hyperlight Drifter there. Wow. What's up? What's up, Zilton? What's up, welcome man? Playing Homestuck, huh? What's Homestuck? MS Paint Adventures? Is that the name of a company? This a game? This is cool. Guess we'll do flask empty. We're gonna have up to three flasks. Flask empty, flask full. Right, let's get that compiling. So I've just added the items for cactus containers. These are like the little pouches. It's not a game per se, but where you control the characters. Nice. Is it cool? You like it? What's up, Dill Shinobi? So we got nine cactus containers. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. Every time you get a cactus container, you can hold more cactuses. Flasks. These things bring you back to life. Flask empty. One, two, three. Full. One, two, three. All right. And we need to hook them up. A lot of other areas, actually. We need a is cactus container. Is empty flask is full flask. People voted on it. Oh, interesting. People voted on that, get on that, what should happen next and stuff. Interesting. Okay, that's good. We got those. Some new functions as well. So, yeah, I'm hooking up some methods so there's going to be some new items in the game. This is going to be really cool to have, be able to hold more cactuses. So, right now the game lets you hold as many cactuses as you want. It's never meant to be, it's never always meant to have been that way. It's meant to be some kind of container like the bomb. So, it's more of a reward as you're playing. As you find a cactus container, you're like, "Yes, I can hold more cactuses now." And it refills your cactuses too whenever you get a cactus container. So, this is going to be a super duper cool item. And also, it's something you find a little bit differently than other types of items. Oh, we need a number of cactus containers. And also a number of flasks. All right, so the max is K-Atom Cactus Container plus K-World Gnome Cactus Containers minus one. It's greater than Cactus Container one and less than max. That looks good. Okay, some more methods we have is empty flask. This is K item flask empty one, K world num flasks. All right, that looks good. You're modding games? What are you modding? Modding? What are you modding? What are you modding, man? Here we got flask full. It's full flask. Flask full. Num flasks. Flask full. Ah. We also need all these items hooked up. So like the bomb container, for example, is cactus container. What's the best game you guys played in 2016? Well, so far for me, that's Hyper Light Drifter. Oh my God, really? You have to create a DLL to add an enemy? That's hard. Yeah, this is a passive item. And if you were to buy one of them, this is an expensive item, but not too expensive, I guess. Two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. Awesome. So is the game you're trying to mod Binding of Isaac, or is you're trying to make another game look like Binding of Isaac? Right, let's crack out the flasks. Oh, so you're modding Binding of Isaac. Ah. So an empty flask, this thing is going to be super valuable. Let's make that 400. However, a full flask, is going to be really cheap because you're just refilling a flask you already have. So you're basically just paying for the liquor. You already have your flask. It's like bringing your coffee cup to the cafe, man. You get it cheap. It's super cheap. So you're the filling up the flask is going to be like 10 diamonds or something. What's up, Kofez? Songbringer's the best game you played, really? If you really mean that, I appreciate you saying that. Thanks, man. And I'm only asking because of, because I'm streaming and stuff, and I don't. Oh, full. I'm like, what's the opposite of empty? There we go. We got three full flasks. All of these are 10 diamonds. So if you have an empty flask, you can refill it. Full, full. It's going good, Kofez. Wow. So you went straight into their library file and unpacked it. That's crazy. Okay, so if I run the game now, I shouldn't have broken anything else by adding these new items. Oh, this is a fairly new save. So I'm gonna back up my save file and grab one that's an advanced save file with a lot of items and stuff. Run that, save it. What world is this? Okay, cool. Oh, that was nice to see some dialogue work just fine and lock the player's input as well. But yeah, this save I have a lot of different items and stuff. And it, let's see, do I have the hyper top hat? Yeah, it goes pretty far. What's up, Ernst? You're learning a lot by watching the streams. Thanks, man. Thanks for saying that. Welcome to the live stream. Hello, and welcome to our crazy crew of people here. We'll be friendly, I promise. Some of your best game I played this year. Really? Last year was Fallout 4. Huge Bethesda fan, but I'm enjoying Songbird more than Fallout. Wow. I'm so honored, PMC, really. The game's not even finished yet. I really hope that it, by the time that Songbringer's finished, that it's just way more awesome than it even is now. So, but that is really, really awesome to hear you say that. And it encourages me a lot, because, for me, I wonder when I like. Sometimes I wonder if the game's good or not, because like, for me, it seems good, and I'm having a great time playing it, and I'm actually kind of addicted to it sometimes. But I wonder if it's the same thing for other people, are other fans of the Zelda series gonna enjoy this game? So it does appear we have all the items, and I have like 24 bombs, and I have 24 life containers. This is pretty good. We can call that good. I think I can check all this in. So what gets named today? I don't know, man. You're gonna have to keep your eyes open for something to name. Did I change the lightning art? No, I did not. I didn't change anything. Did something? Let's check that out, because maybe something. Did I mess something up recently that messed up the lightning art? Yeah, it's the same art, same thing. Okay, so I'm gonna check out this diff and go ahead and check this in and work on the other items on my list. Oh yeah, that's the lightning bomb. Yeah, that was a lightning bomb. It makes lightning hit anything that hits within the bomb range or whatever, the area of effect. We got 9 cactus containers. Nothing is hooked up. None of these are placed in the world, but it's good to have these all the way hooked up in the constants at least. We got empty flasks, three of them. Three full flasks, cactus containers, functions, empty flask container functions. Full, all these look like they have the right numbers and everything. 1 through 9, 1 through 3. Okay, let's check that in. Okay, next thing on the list, I want to do, yeah, making it so dialogue and lens takes a second before it can run. I think that an easy way to do this would be to give every area like a lifetime timer type thing. Do I already have that? Don't think I do. So whenever I create an area, it'll just set the timer for that area. Yeah, I'll call it uptime. Yeah, uptime. And then we'll have like a get uptime and an add uptime. Get uptime. Add uptime. Did you see the video about Ubuntu on Windows? Yeah, so I was just hearing about that from who was mentioning it earlier just a second ago? Arcane. Yeah, Arcane was mentioning it. Yeah, so you're saying it's all of Ubuntu on Windows, really? You don't like the shark things that shoot you with the orbs? So what is it that you don't like about them? Is it a genuine dislike? Like, do you wish the game didn't have them, or is it sort of like a they're just a really challenging thing? Maybe they shoot too many bubbles right now at this point. They shoot like three bubbles. They are kind of a difficult enemy, I guess. So each area has an uptime now. When the area is created, uptime is always 0. Area get uptime. That's a double delta. Think they will put the Ubuntu's kernel, really? And make a layer on top of this to make the features accessible. Oh my gosh, that would be amazing if they. It would be amazing if they did it right. I hope they don't mess this up though. If the really the thing they should do, if they're gonna do this with Windows, they might as well just kill all of Windows's. They might as well just switch to Ubuntu. Seriously. So tell me, let's watch like a little video on this. Is there like a 2-minute video or blog post, I guess? So it's Bash on Ubuntu running on Windows. So that's awesome. I'm really, really excited about this. Vim. Oh, V. It's V, huh? So, okay, about that enemy. My hate for them is like the creeper in Minecraft. I hate it, but I still want it in the game. Maybe it does shoot too much, but it always made me stand on my feet, and it was a cool feeling. Okay. Cool. So it's a good thing, but maybe they are a little bit too tough at their current difficulty. Let me add this to my notes for my current design notes. I gotta get all these design notes added to the Trello, but let's do that enemy is called the Karsh. Make Karsh shoot less bubbles at lower difficulties. Okay, that'll get in the games at some point. The Windows subsystem for Linux. The addition of a Linux command line to Windows was announced. Yeah, this is so cool. Yeah, so it's not Vim. You can activate this on some Windows 10 builds. You haven't tried it yet? I haven't tried it yet either, I guess, of course. Okay, so you can turn off. Oh, Windows features, Windows subsystem for Linux. Interesting. Now, this is probably one of the coolest things I've seen Microsoft do in the my entire history of looking at what Microsoft does. Jonah, Karsh is too camouflaged. I totally agree. Yeah, the Karsh is way too camouflaged. When I drew it, it looked less and also be more visible. Rigged. Loaded. What are we rigging? Right? So you got to enable developer mode. Select Windows from your Windows features. And then you can just open a command prompt, type bash. And then you're prompted to install. It's not an emulator, but rather redirects Linux syscalls to Windows equivalents. Okay. I mean, other than rewriting all of Windows, that is probably the best thing they could do. It's just reroute everything to Windows equivalents, which would make me a hell of a lot more comfortable on Windows in the command line. Oh, you're talking about rig for. Did somebody try? Hello, retired programmer, what's up? That's awesome. Debian packages, hell yeah. I would definitely want apt-get, but that's so cool. You can install apt. I mean, you can install things with apt-get. Yeah, running in native, that's so cool. This is actually really awesome. When you're in Bash, you're actually running Ubuntu 14.04, which is old, but who cares? And then you can just install app. Wow. You get GCC, everything you would need. You cannot run Windows executables directly from Bash, though. Oh, well, that makes sense. That means it really is a Unix system there you're running. Steam machines are the worst. Why? Okay, tell me, retired programmer, why are the Steam machines the worst? I don't even know anything about Steam machines. This nice quote, Jonah. Oh, they run horrible on SteamOS. Oh. Yeah, who knows where they install it, but this is kind of cool. It's by no means perfect. Top doesn't work. DF doesn't work. Well, MySQL doesn't work. That's really awesome. Wow. We really are in 2016, aren't we? We got Microsoft putting Linux on their OS, and Hyperlight Drifter just came out. What could be better, man? And then later this year, we'll have Songbringer, and hopefully we have Below, too. Shit. There's some sweet games. When does Below come out? Does anybody know? This is like a big year for Zelda-like games. It's still just 2016. Wait, this is 10.06. Oh, that was 13. Yeah, it looks like it's coming out. Oh, it does say Q2, Q3. So sometime this summer-ish. When you thought Bill Gates knew how to punch, he goes there and kicks you in the head. Java had its own OS. I didn't know that. Okay, so did I check that in? I think I checked that other stuff in, but now I'm on the uptime. Yeah, uptime. Okay, so now we just need to add some uptime and reset the uptime when it creates. Prep shadows, prep reflections. Here we go. So at the very end of all this, we're going to go uptime equals zero. This is right where it creates the area. And then when we're ticking, some kind of system needs to update the uptime for the current area. Input system comes to mind as a good place to put this. Input system tick already has the area. It already checks if it's paused as well. So maybe this is a good place for it. I think I'm going to put it here. I mean, other than putting it in its own like area tick, what other systems would be good places for this? Layer system, maybe, not really. Yeah, I guess here is fine. This is a good place to put it. All right, so add to areas uptime. If we're not paused, area to add uptime delta. So there we go. We got some added uptime. It's because you couldn't see sharp. Yeah. Okay, so now we've got some added uptime. And Microsoft also took over Xamarin. Oh, I didn't know that. Somebody was just asking about Xamarin the other day. They released it for total free use. Easier for C sharp. Man, the moves they're making. They're seriously making some strong moves this year, huh? They've probably been planning this for a while. I imagine Microsoft's had this in the works for, I don't know, a couple years. So they would do this. What's up, baby? Okay, so now it just needs to check for the uptime in the story system. Oops, story sys. So to run an action, we need to be within a margin and current area's uptime. I'm thinking this should go something like this. Bool can proceed. I'm trying to make this clear. Can proceed is false if action not first is dialogue or lens. Actually, we should do a better function for that too. Let's make this a list of action keys that are delayed. So delayed action keys, and also we have a const double k story action delay. I'm gonna go ahead and guess about 1.618 seconds would be good. So there's two delayed action keys, there's dialogue and lens. Both of those require a slight delay before they can run. And I can simply just add more to this list of things if I want to add. Yeah, that's going to be good. Delayed action keys. Microsoft's pleasing the developers. Yes, it is, right? Wait, oh, what's up? Sorry, I missed some things here. It's from Spud. What's up, Spud? In the process of converting some of my live GDX stuff over to mono game. Oh, interesting. Yeah, C over Java. Yeah, I've heard some really great things about C Sharp. I've never actually used C Sharp, but I know Boogie Codes in C Sharp, and it's a great it's a really from what I can understand, it's a very friendly, awesome language to use. Even Apple to agree when they dropped the requirement to have a developer account. Yeah, that's also right. They did that. And what else did Apple do recently? They started trying to make Swift more cross-platform. I think they released, didn't they release the like the open up the licensing for Swift or something like that too? I don't know. So if this is, if contains, this is K delayed, no, delayed action keys, contains this action key, which is action.first, then can proceed is if we're within the margin, and area dot get uptime is greater than k story action delay. So here, and then we just go if can proceed. So hopefully this is reads a bit better now. It's a lot more simple and clear. Why can't we invent some special CD which works on both Xbox, PS4, and PC? Some special CD? What's a CD? PS4.5? What do we think about VR? I think that sentiment is quite common, right? That most people think that VR is going to take a while. And I think it's true. If you've used any of the VR devices, they're kind of heavy at this point, and they're kind of bulky, you know what I mean? They're just not quite perfect yet. But this generation that we're seeing right now of VR right now is playable, right? It's playable, but I don't think it's perfect yet. Yeah, we got another. Yep. First gen VR, bad idea. I think that's probably the biggest sentiment out there, right? Nobody wants to be first to try out VR, really. Oh, see, the CD, like a real actual CD. Oh. But that's the whole point of them having their own unique CDs, is they get to keep their customers using their own CDs. Okay, I'm going to make sure this all works still. We got the action. We got the area. We start off with can proceed false. No, can proceed is true by default. And then if it... This is delayed action keys must wait. Proceed to run this action. Don't proceed with tick because we either ran the action or are waiting for it to run. Okay, so hopefully that's all like just more readable. Just make sure this part's working. You're at VR porn at Google Cardboard. Contains delayed action keys, action not first, can proceed if only if we have uptime and we're within the margin. Okay, so let's test this out. First of all, the very first action should run still. Right? Is it doing well? I don't know. I don't have VR. Can't tell you. Oh, yeah, it did wait a second before it ran that time. But does it stop me from moving? I should be able to move around. Oh, yeah. Okay, good. So it stopped me as soon as it started the dialogue. If I were to run off the screen... Right, Silky? So if I try and run off the screen, or at least to the edge of the screen, actually if I hang out over here, it won't let me create a dialogue. Same thing here because I'm on the edge of the screen, but if I get closer and closer and closer towards the middle, yeah, at some point it allows me to start the dialogue. Okay, good. Now let's make it so Brutus appears. Virtual sex machine. Man, that would be really hard to explain, right? Oh my god. Man. That's crazy. For me, Jib went from R2-D2 to C-3PO now that he speaks English. Okay, yeah. So how has your experience been for that? Do you still enjoy the game? Do you enjoy the game more? Do you enjoy the game less now that Jib speaks English? Wait a minute. Okay, so Brutus should be able to appear now. Alright, there's Brutus. Oh, and I guess I was part of the... I was within the uptime. Okay, let's see that again from the side. You want a refund? He's less funny, but it's okay. Alright. Maybe, I thought maybe he should start the game not talking English and then you immediately get the translator. I don't know. Well, maybe there's another character that talks in alien all the time. Alright, here we go. Yeah, so I'm on the edge and it's not allowing me to talk to him just yet, but at least it put him there. And if I leave and come back, I'm trying to mess the system up here, it should be okay. Yeah, it's okay. Good, so it didn't lock me into anything until it started the dialogue. The only problem here is that Jib and Rock are off the screen a bit now. Oh, because you were making it up, huh? That's funny. I think this is a great check-in here. It just basically uses uptime for an area to measure when it should start some dialogue. Dialogue can't start until a bit of uptime elapses. Good check-in. Let me get this off my list now. All right, so the next thing is going to be making him walk closer. How am I distributing the closed beta? Yeah, so you basically can pre-order the game, Selkie, and you can do that at songbringer.com/pre-order. And basically, when you pre-order the game, you get a Steam key. Actually, if you pre-order at $32, you get a Steam key immediately. And then you can play the beta version on Steam. So you enter the Steam key in. And then from then on, you own Songbringer, the beta, and you also will own the final version when it comes out. You can also pre-order the game just at its regular price of $16. And that gets you the game when it comes out, but also gets you your name in the credits. So there's that. So basically what I'm doing is I'm avoiding early access and I'm avoiding open betas. Yes, Arcane, Jib is in English. How did I create controller support? I'm using a library called OIS. It's a cross-platform controller library. Here, I'll post this link in the chat. You're gonna animate a character? Cool. We'll see you, Kofez. Okay, so the next thing on my list here is to make it so the heroes walk closer to the middle of the screen, if they can. So Donald Trump doesn't deport him. All right, so how am I going to get the players to walk closer? I need a wall. A wall. Right? What's this guy gonna come up with next? So what I would like to see there is I'd like to see the player just walk a little bit more towards the center of the screen. And then Jim also walks towards the center of the screen, but is sort of farther away from Rock. I'm not exactly sure. What if Jib previously had a body? He did. He did. Yep, I tell some of the story on the Steam page there. But the Jib has a long history, and in Jib's history, he forgets. He actually forgets at some point some of his history. So when he wakes up on Songbringer, oh, if he had a robot body for a while. Well, he no, he well, that's an interesting question. What if he did? Because the story I've written so far has him just inside the Skybot body. What if Jib's mind is Trump's mind? But the robot head was removed, and the human put his mind in there. Interesting. I'm trying to think of how to do this. To make players walk around, I mean, the simplest thing to do is to leave the game so it's not paused. So the player can just keep moving the way that their move system already moves the player. The problem with that, though, is that the game is paused already because you're running dialogue. So I guess you could do it when you zoom in. Technically, it hasn't stopped the player's input until you finish zooming in. Is that right? Let me see if that's right. Why waste a sweet metal bod? Okay, I'm gonna test if. When it starts zooming, if I can keep moving. Yeah. Oh, while it's zooming, I can move. Jibbediah? Nice, I like this. I like this, Zilton. So, if the. I guess it would be a good thing to make it. Yeah, to make it. The players move while. I guess it could be a walk to Flux, even. So, it would like run a different action for the walk to. What's up, Yame? I think I'm gonna leave this one for last. I should think about that. What's the, it's like, this is a tricky one because it's like, I want the players to move, but there's a possibility that we pause the game. There's already some code in place which moves the player inside the fluxes. So if I did a walk to action, that would be a same thing as a, as I should call this walk to flux. Walk to flux would work. I should think about that for a minute. So I'll keep that at the end of my list for now. So let's do this. We'll check the intro to make sure it's still working. Actually, we'll do this first. These two. Brutus can spawn even if it's not an open interior. Right, let's do that. For this, I think there needs to be two types of spawn. Right now, there's a spawn, which means spawn on any area that has an open interior. If we had like spawn any, that would mean you can spawn this on any type of area. We might as well do gates as well. So yeah, I'm gonna try this out. Spawn any. What shall I waste my points on? Am I procrastinating? Or was he procrastinating? Yeah, I think that's good. Spawn any. So we'll add this kind of action. We've got spawn. We've also got spawn any. And both spawn and spawn any use the spawn action. However, spawn any can happen anywhere, but spawn. Yeah, so let's do this. Has spawn. Has spawn any. Whoa, Jonah. You're getting close to a 50%er. Has spawn any. So if we have has spawn or has spawn any, we do this. And if we don't have spawn any, then we need to check the interior. Okay. I think that little snippet of code there should do it. Let's make sure this action spawn will still work. Yeah, this is still going to do all the exact same stuff. It does do a last faux pause, but last faux pause should be renamed to last spawn pause now. You're saving up for a friend. Nice. You're addicted to Homestuck already. All right, so to how to test this? This should make it so Brutus can appear like anywhere. Raffle him for a trip to Hawaii. It's not gambling. Nice. Yeah, cool. We can have him here on this screen, for example. This is great. So basically, all I wanted to do there was make it so this NPC can appear on any screen. It doesn't have to happen with an open interior. Oh, but it would need to spawn close to the player. Oh, this area kind of sucks. I can't get to within the margin. That's a problem. Okay, so I gotta fix this. I'm gonna take a quick little break. I'll be right back, and I'm gonna start fixing this bug where the guy's not talking. Thank you. Maybe he's just having a bad day. Maybe he's having a good day. Sutter, you name something else. Okay, let's make him... Right now, I waste to proceed until it's within a certain margin area. Let's really reduce that margin. Like his teeth fell out. That would be a bad problem to have in your mouth. Okay, yeah, so we can run some dialogue now. I mean, it is kind of weird to see it smashed way at the top of the screen like that. And it's not zoomed right. But if I took away the zoom, it would work fine. So, but the zoom is the last thing on my list, so that's cool. I can spawn, the next thing you need to do is make sure the spawn happens in a place where, where you can get to it. So, basically, it can't ever spawn an NPC. Let's check this in so far. We've got spawn any. Spawn any, last spawn, pause, spawn any. Spawn any command. Yeah, put it below the character if it's on top. Yeah. Yep. I think that could be solved too, also by zooming better. But yeah, it should just do that. If it's way up high, it'll put it right below the character. Yeah, it needs to spawn near the player. Oh, the best thing to do is to find an area that would break Brutus completely. Or it would look like it would break. It wouldn't actually break Brutus, but at least it would look really weird. If Brutus spawned in a place that you couldn't get to, and you still talked with him. Oh, I was like, why didn't it change? I'm like, oh, because it's a different world, see? That's alright. So I need an area where I can't get all the way through it. Or there's part of it I can get to from one screen and part from another, like this one. This is a good example. Okay, so I'm gonna save my game here. And then take away the compass. Yeah, like left or right, exactly. Just like this exact situation right here. Okay, so it spawned me right next to Brutus. But that was lucky. Okay, let's find another area. Because that just worked. Everything's crashing down on you in the game. So I need another area that's sort of split. It's got like a... part you can get to, part you can't. Like this one, maybe. Mm-hmm. They were totally hiding. Oh no, what happened, man? Same thing, we got lucky with this one again. There's gotta be an area where it's not, we're not getting lucky. I'm purposely looking for an area where it's not luckily working. This is dangerous. Don't do this at home, kids. Oh, this one. Oh no, you can get around that barrier. Here's another one. This one could be, maybe. Where's the player? What? Oh, that's where Jib is. Whoa, how did the player get in the middle of the screen here? This is crazy messed up. What happened here? Oh my god, look at this. Where's the player? We found another bug while we're... Yeah, it totally spawned the player in the middle. Oh my god, there's actually a little hole in these mountains. Oh. Look at this, I'm totally stuck in this little hole. Wow. Let me take a screenshot just in case I don't want to fix this right now. Let me check it out though. It's a feature, secret hole. Secret hole, anyone? Anybody want a secret hole? We were talking about sex machines a minute ago. It is an amazing discovery, right? I think it started happening recently when I added taller mountains. So I want to see if I can fix this really quick. I'm going to go to create mountain tile and see if there's something obvious. With the new heights, it could be a higher mountain. So, and then it only puts the bottom... Only puts the collision in there. So if I take that off, it should put a collision for every single one of these tiles. You fell for it, right? Nice, Mutinous. Nice one. No, that did not fix it. Okay, if I go into God mode, it should allow me to walk on this stuff. And I'm out of God mode. I can't walk on this. I'm trying to see if there's any other holes. Like, if maybe that's a hole too. Nope, there's just a hole right here. Crazy! Wow, I wonder where else that happens. Huh. The road to debugging has no end. Yeah, Boogie's got some nice wisdom there. Thanks, Boogie. Thanks for reminding me of this. Sometimes it totally does feel like the road to debugging has no end. But Boogie brings up a good point. The moment you finally stop adding features, it does get easier. Okay, I have to come check this later because I don't know how or why this is happening here. So I'm just going to name this screenshot though. Bug hole in mountains. Okay, well, let's continue the search, looking for an area that breaks Brutus, and then we'll make sure he can be fixed. Yes, the moment you finally stop adding features, and then you fix all the bugs with your existing features, you're not sure that moment exists, right? Looking for another area that would break. I mean, I guess if I don't find one, I can always force the system to break. So, like, use a position. Here's one. The player could be up top. Brutus could be down below. He's probably not, though. But this is a good enough area to try. Finally, my game is all finished. The feature creep. You can never have too many enemy types. Oh my god, that guy. That guy. Feature creeper. So tempting to give in to the feature creeper coming back. No, don't let the feature creeper come back. Alright, so anyways. Oh, this has both the problems I need to fix anyways on one. Okay, so if I change this and make it so. What's the diff so far? Nothing. Okay, good. If I change it so when it spawns. An NPC. You can only use. Some higher positions on the Y, so like let's make them all these 0.7. You should make an online competitive mod. Nice joke, nice joke, game. I like that a lot. Online competitive mode, are you kidding me? That would take at least 2 more years. I've done competitive online games before, man. Take a long time. I just noticed that those bushes are totally messed up. But anyways, okay, so now we have the situation pretty clear, right? Brutus is on one side trying to talk to me, and I'm down here on the bottom. We don't want that to happen. We want it to spawn the NPC always close to the player. Right? Don't know if anyone would actually ever do that. Add competitive online. That is a lot of work. I'm thinking there should be six different positions on the screen that he could place the NPC, and then it chooses the one which is closest to the player. Yeah, right, let's do it. So we would have. Someone would do it. I would hope. When I use my code, there we go. There's some clean, concise code. When someone else uses my code, how the heck does this even work? Nice. Mealy? Mealy's got a good one for us game devs. I love Mealy. Mealy and extra credits, those are like my favorite. When I use someone else's code. Why do you use that? That's the dereference operator. Well, not the dereference operator, it's the peer inside a pointer's data type thing. Are you asking seriously? Or not serious, it's just a funny joke. There's lots of different dereference operators. If you had an int pointer, p equals something. You would go P and oh no, say you had a structure, right? Like a struct with an integer A and a float B or whatever, and you had an instance of this structure named S, you would go S dot A equals one or whatever, right? But if you had a pointer to that same struct, so let's go auto PS, which is the pointer to the struct, equals the address of the struct. There. Now I have a pointer to that struct, and I would have to use this operator to get at that A. Oh, sorry, PS A equals one or whatever. Do you get that? See what I'm saying? This dot operator accesses a member, and so does this one, but it accesses the member of a pointer. Yes, Jonah, yeah. Right. In that case it is just verbosity, right? If I'm going this get ran 1f or whatever, I'm just using it for verbosity to make it clear when I'm accessing a member function versus just calling get ran 1f, which is also technically C++ just fine. It's just that it's not very clear if you're using a static method and, you know, a member function or whatever. You're just gonna say with JavaScript. Got it, got it. Oh yeah. Okay, so I hope that explained it. What that operator is. So we need three more of these. We got halfway. Make that 5 5. Or 6. Yeah, I'll do 6. 4 6 and 6 6. There, we got six different positions an NPC could be at. And we're gonna choose one. Right now it's choosing one at random, which is no good. We don't wanna do that. We wanna choose one smartly based on the closest distance to the player. Right. Yes. Yeah, Yam. It's technically useless to write this, right? From a the compiler's perspective, it doesn't matter at all that I just wrote this. And in fact, that's exactly the same thing. But to me as a programmer, this is more readable because if I wanted to go, I can understand quickly at a glance that that's a member function. Versus this, I don't know if that's a member function or a global function or whatever. Okay, so we need a closest distance. We're going to loop over all the positions. Yeah, I might as well make this a vector. Let's make this easier. We can loop over the vector easily. So vector of vec2 positions initialized with these positions. Rigged again. I just won again. Who's saving up right now? Who's looking to? Jonah. We'll give some to Jonah. Why not just remove Wizard Fu's name from the free parking? It's a good idea. Yeah, it'll get you to, it'll definitely get you to understand memory. And you don't even need to use, you don't even need to really learn C++ to learn all its basics. If you just learn C, that's a great thing. You'll understand memory like crazy good. All right, so we've got positions now. We don't need number of positions. But we'll go for auto pause in positions. Load disk, and we need the player's position. Do we have the player in any of this function? Not yet. Hero pause is game scene. Hero 0 position. Dot pause distance. Oh, let's do a vec2 for that. Distance is hero pause dot distance squared to pause. The math is hard there, right? Red Sands wants points too. Red Sands, you're in luck because I got lots of points to give. Yeah, right? You can easily write awful code in a few languages. If the distance is less than the closest then the closest is the dist and the position is the pause and we need to set the valid pause to true there. So now just put it right by the Player, do we already have pause? Think we already have this variable. Okay, we can't name it that. We got to name it something like maybe underscore p. Oh, good. I'm down to some reasonable amount of points. Only 6,000. When I see when you were a kid. All right, let's see how that turned out. Set a breakpoint here. Whenever it chooses a position for an NPC that it likes, it should do that for the first position for sure. So it should always put the 2 feed one bullet. Crazy hard to do, but I'm sure it's possible, right? All right, so this should be the first position. We got an array of a vector of positions here, which just has a size of 6. The first one is 210, 96. So this position underscore p should be 210, 96. Yeah. It's the closest distance. 3600. Set the position. Let's run it again. See. Oh, that was it. That was definitely the closest because it was. Okay, but if I walked in from off screen, now I need an off screen position. Math is hard. I started here. Oh yeah, what time is it? Hold on a second. Let me see how much time I got. I'll be there in like 10 minutes. But yeah, go ahead and start without me, man.
I can wait if you're gonna be 10 minutes.
Yeah, I'll be 10 minutes.
Okay, I'll wait.
All right. All right, 10 minutes left on the screen. You hear that? We got dinner coming soon. I can't stream much longer. Okay, so all I need to do is check, and all I'm gonna do the rest of today's stream is just make sure that it now spawns the enemy close to, or spawns the NPC. So if I would need to start. I know what to do. If I take away every position I've already been to, except for what's this? I think it's stories. Dinner on the Barbie. 12 positions. Okay, if I take it down to like 12, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. I think if I delete all these, I should be able to run on to this other screen. Nope. Okay, I need to take away one more. And start the player one more to the left. Okay, so now I should be able to walk to the right and it will trigger him. Oh no, I need one less position, I guess. What is my graduation? What do you mean by graduation? But thank you. Thanks for saying that. PMC, well, we're gonna miss you, man. Yeah, we'll see you, PMC. We'll see you when you get back, man. Oh, do I have a PhD? No, I'm a college dropout. I really am. Yeah, so there, it did work. Okay, so it spawned him up top. So if I were to be at 12:07, let's see that again. Yeah, PMC, have a good one, man. We're gonna see you when you get back. Hope it's a good time.
Whoa!
Yeah, good. That time I put him there. It looks like he's not put him enough to the right and the left, though. So I'll just make it so he can go a little more. Go 3-5, maybe even 3 there. 3-7. Yeah, there you go. He's a little bit more to the right that time. Good. And let's see that once again from the other side. Yeah, face him totally. Yeah, he's gonna I got some an idea for that where he'll actually face the player always. So he'll like always look at you. So it'll be like that'll make him a little bit more realistic and stuff. Nice, that worked fine. It's taught you the difference between stack and heap memory. Yeah. I know. Yep. These things that I didn't know. That's a really great thing to know, man. Oh, there we have a bug. Okay, so that time. Oh no, wait. I guess this is. If I were to, I would have to put these to 0.3 and 0.7 as well. Did you have a lot of Songbird's engine planned out ahead of time? No, I did not. I just implemented new things as I needed them, White Rice. It's a good question. But I did know when I started Songbringer, I did do one thing that I knew from Songbringer's engine. I knew I wanted to use an entity component system. And that did guide this game like crazy. Like if I hadn't done an entity component system, I'd be a 6 months behind at this point. Because entity component systems will just save you from having to write lots of code. It helps you to design your systems really well and keep your data all organized and everything. So that looks good. It looks like we're now spawning the players or the NPCs close to the player. So if there's a break in the area like this one right here, it'll put the NPC within reach. Nice, man. Yeah. So I hope these streams are inspiring. I also hope they're educational and really, I mean, my whole motive for even doing the streams is just to share this game. That's all I want. All I want to do is make a cool game and share the game with as many people as possible. So that's all I'm doing here. I'm just making people aware of Songbringer, but also, you know, the side effect is that I also get to help people. I also get to show code. I also get to hopefully be inspiring and show people that they can do it too. Like if one guy can do this whole game, you can do something cool too. What is it? What do you want to do in life? What's your deepest dreams, man? Like what is it? If you were to make a video game, what would be the ultimate video game you ever made? That's how I started this game off, Songbringer. I was like, what would be the very what if I could only create one more thing in my entire life, what would it be? That was the question I had to answer when I started Songbringer, and I was like, okay. I thought about it really hard and long. I kind of wanted to create an album as well, so I was like, maybe I'll create an album. But then I was like, no, I really want to write a game. So I was like, let's write a game and an album. Why not? So eventually there will be enough music to call this an album as well. But yeah, anyways, hope that helps. Nice guys. Where did I get my start in games? I did work for studios and stuff back in the day. I've worked for Trilobite, the people that made The Seventh Guest, 11th Hour. I worked for other small companies in my hometown in Medford, Oregon, things like that. But most of my career, I've worked alone on projects. I've also worked with friends. I've worked with friends on also our own indie projects and things like that. But this is the very first game I've made all myself. So, yeah. So yeah, that's it for today's stream. I'm still working on this NPCs and making everything really awesome for them. This is a random NPC encounter, so that's why it has to have some new logic and stuff like that added to the game. So this will be cool to have a random NPC encounter because it'll kind of add a different mode of gameplay. So, anyways, we'll catch you guys next time. I think I'll probably be streaming tomorrow. I'm not sure. So yeah, we'll catch you guys later. Thanks for watching.